about what God is doing. That's an awesome testimony. So, man, let's just continue in that place of just thanking God. You guys excited?
Yes.
Well, guess what? I'm about to go for the next 7 hours.
Yeah.
About revival. All right, anyways. It's about 12 o'clock here, so if you just give me 20 minutes of your time, I'm going to cut down a little bit on the sermon because I know we're kind of going on time. We want to get out of here about 12:30, so if you just give me just a few minutes of your time, and we'll bless the Lord with what God wants to do in today. If you would turn with me to Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 8, would you put a finger in there? And also Genesis chapter 50, verses 15 through 20. We're going to be going on in our series entitled From Pit to Pinnacle. From Pit to Pinnacle. And would you stand with me?
God is good. I love it.
I love it, man. I love every time we hear from men of God which are in the battlefield. A lot of times in the context, we think about what's going on here in the United States, and we don't realize that the battle is being fought in different platforms, different areas, and what God is doing. And sometimes we're like, oh my goodness, you know, we don't have our own building. Man, there's people out there in the bush, right? And they're preaching the gospel. Right? And they're fighting against witch doctors. Come on, somebody. Right? And so we can come in here and some of the little things that we go through on a daily basis don't seem as big. Right? Because we know that we got God on our side. And let me tell you something. The same God that's in India, that's in Africa, that's in China is here today. Amen? I'm going to be preaching a message entitled today under the subheading of the series Pit to Pinnacle, Forgiveness That Brings You Out.
Amen.
Can we repeat that? Forgiveness that brings you out. Come on, I'm going to read this scripture, and then we're going to go into prayer. Please remain standing as we read scripture and pray. Chapter 45, verses 1 through 8. Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 8. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all of them that stood by him. And he cried, because every man to go out from me. And there stood no man with him. And while Joseph made himself known unto his brethren, he wept aloud. And the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph. Doth my father yet live? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. And Joseph said unto the brethren, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near, and he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. Now therefore be not grieved nor angry with yourselves, that you sold me hither, for God did send me before you to preserve life. For this 2 years hath famine been on the land, yet there are 5 years in which there shall neither be earnings nor harvest. And God sent me before you, let's underline that, and God sent me before you to preserve you as posterity in the earth, and save your lives by great deliverance. So now it was not to you that sent me hither, but God. And he hath made me a father of Pharaoh, and the Lord of all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. Let's go on to chapter 50, verses 15 through 20. And when Joseph's brethren saw that their father was dead, they said, Joseph, will peradventure hate us, and will certainly requite us all the evil which we did unto him. And they sent a messenger unto Joseph, saying, thy father did command before he died, saying, so shall ye say unto Joseph, forgive, I pray thee, now the trespass of the brethren and their sin, for they did not unto thee evil. And now we pray thee, forgive the trespass of the servants of God, of the father. And Joseph wept when they spake unto him. And his brethren also went and fell down before his face, and they said, behold, we are thy servants. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for I am in the place of God. But for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass all that is this day, to save much people alive. Now therefore fear not, I will nourish you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spake kindly unto them. While we're there, why don't we also, Romans chapter 5, verses 8 says that while we were yet sinners, Christ did die for us. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray even now that your sweet presence comes into this place. Lord, Father God, I pray, Lord, that I remain faithful to the text, that I preach what you have set before us, Father God. Lord, that I don't try to implement what's in my heart, Father God, but I implement what's in your heart. Speak to me now, Father. Let, Father God, all that have ear to hear, let them hear. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Forgiveness that brings you through. I think one of the hardest things to do in life, and this is just my opinion, that's why I said I think, one of the hardest things to do in life is to forgive someone, especially when they don't deserve it, right? Like, I have a story which I want to tell you real quick. Is I remember my freshman year of college, I was at Bible college, and I hated the food there at Bible college. You go to school and you're eating the food, and it's good for the first couple of weeks, right? It's really good. But week after week, it's the same thing. And it's just like, Lord, if I see another fajita, I'm going to kill it. You know what I'm saying? And so, man, I had these awesome and gracious parents which would send me money because I was a hardworking college student. They would send me money, and so what I did was I would go to Walmart, and as a college student, you learn how to budget, you know, your income. So you know what I did? Do I have some college students in here?
Raymond.
Right? Ramen noodles. Hey, you know it. Right, I looked at Kyle and Tyler, they were like, Raymond noodles. And so I went and got me a big old box. Let me tell you. And I took that box and I had it, and I knew exactly how many Raymond noodles I had. 24. Right? And they were delicious. The best Raymond noodles that anyone could ever see. And so I left them up there. I even bragged to my friends, guess what I got? I'm not going to the lunchroom, I got Raymond noodles. And so my friends were obviously jealous. They knew there was more room, and I told them, I said, anytime that you want some rain noodles, just come in and I'll get them for you. So I left out that day. I come back to my room, and it was like I had spiders since that day. I walk in, right? And something, before I even looked at the ramen noodles, I just felt it in my spirit. Now, how many of you know that when you're just moving and with the gift of the Holy Spirit, you can just feel it, right? Like, something is amiss. I didn't even count those ramen noodles, but I knew somebody had taken one of them. And I was like, man, somebody's going to get it. Somebody's going to get it. And so I went and I counted. I said, wait a second, there was 24 ramen noodles right here. I had the spicy kind. I had the curry kind. One is missing. What's going on? So I go outside to the room and I sit there and I start yelling and getting upset. I said, hey, whoever has taken my ramen noodles, it's about to go down. So nobody came out. It was a couple of days. My friends started teasing me. So I said, no, I'm gonna squash all this. And I went out and I'm telling you, listen, the story's funny, but I was literally ready. I was not quite sanctified quite yet. I was literally ready to lay Holy Ghost hands on somebody. And I told him, I said, if I don't get my ramen noodles by the end of this day, it's going to go down. One of my friends came back to me. He says, Elijah, let me tell you something, man. I am so sorry. I know me and you are friends. I didn't think that you would mind if I took a ramen noodle. I took one. And man, I was so upset. But when he said he was sorry, does everybody know what the lemon face is? I gave him the lemon face. I said, man, I can't be upset anymore. And I had to forgive. It was the hardest thing. I said, you know what? I forgive you. This is what, in a roundabout way, which I'm trying to get to, happens, right? We tend not to want to forgive, especially when that person, he stole my noodles. This is the point of the story. He stole my noodles. I didn't want to forgive him. We find Joseph. As I move from the silly example to the text here, we find Joseph almost in the same predicament. His brothers had sold them into slavery for something that he did not do. Right? They had thrown him in a pit. They had thought about killing him. 17 years, Joseph is away from his family. In a land that he does not know. In a with a tongue that he doesn't quite understand.
Right.
He's away from his family and thrown in prison, accused of rape when he didn't do it. This is what's going on right now in the text as we go into the next chapters here on our series, verses 42 through 45. Joseph meets his brothers face to face for the very first time. Can you imagine it? A lot of times when we read scripture, right, we tend to look at it as almost robotic. And we kind of talked about this in our Wednesday Bible studies. And if you're not coming, man, I encourage you to come. They're so beneficial. And I mean, this last Wednesday, man, the Spirit of God was really there. We really dug deep into scripture. And a lot of times we talked about when we come to scripture, we look at scripture almost in this robotic box, right? We look at it in this box and we think these people that we're reading were not real people, right? And so when they go through these hard times, right, and they go through these hard situations, it's like, yeah, okay, you threw me into the dungeon and you beat me and I had to go through this, but I forgive you. But that's not reality. These are stories about people that live real lives, that have real emotions. And we look at the text right here and we see Joseph face to face for the first time with his brothers. Could you imagine what is going in his heart right here? Could you imagine what's happening in Joseph's life right here in scripture? As he sees that, like, that emotion that wells up inside, that understanding, like, it was them, I see them for the first time. It's not like when Joseph becomes second, he's like, okay, now I'm going to go back to my family, and I'm going to confront my brothers with all of Egypt's army, and I'm like, hey, I am here.
Yeah.
No, that's not what happens. He sees them for the very first time. I can only imagine. I know, as I was looking through the scripture, I was digging in, I was like, how could I probably correlate? I could imagine that anxiety feeling that just wells up inside of you. Like, you know, some of you which dated someone a very long, long time ago, you broke up with that person, maybe. I'm just getting out of old folks here. But when you broke up with that person, and then you haven't seen them in a while, and then you see them across the street, and you get that feeling inside, like, I can imagine something like that in the text, like, oh my goodness, it's them. And it, not only is it them, but they don't recognize me. And not only do they not recognize me, but they kind of come to me. And that's what's happening here in the text as we're going through this scripture right here, that Joseph's brothers, he meets them face to face for the very first time. It had to have been hard. We see Joseph emotional as we go through scripture. I'm not going to go through it piece by piece, but we see Joseph emotional as he puts his brothers through test after test after test, right? Prisoning one of the brothers, Benjamin, sticking a cup into the food bag, right? Tell them that they have to bring the younger brother. We see them going through test after test after test. And through these tests, as you continue to read this scripture, and I'm asking you, please read this scripture. Continue to go through these scriptures, chapters 42 through 45, right? Go through these scriptures. We see Joseph in every situation, like he was so overwhelmed with emotion that he had to walk away. The Bible says that he walked into his secret place and he wept aloud. To where his servants were like, man, what is going on? Emotion that's spilling out as he's dealing with, man, are these brothers still the same? I have to test them. Are they still the same? I'm sure in that context, a lot of times we probably believe that, man, Joseph was already over all the situation, that he had already forgiven them. But as he's working through his process of forgiveness, more than likely, weeping heavy tears, right? We see Joseph here in this context having to work out, how do I forgive? And the question comes up, how do we forgive? Are we still bound in unforgiveness? Like we see it here in the text. Are we still bound in unforgiveness? I believe that Joseph realized To not forgive is to remain in the pit of unforgiveness.
Yes.
Like, a lot of times, we can overcome that major barrier that kind of came across our lives. Like, for example, if a parent says, man, you'll never make it. You'll never make it. And you finally make it, right? You get that job, you get that promotion, and you get your degree and all those different things. And a lot of times we feel like, man, once we make it, it's sweet and satisfied. But if you hold on to that unforgiveness, you're still held trying to get out of this pit. And a lot of times, in unforgiveness, we're stuck in that bottomless pit.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter how far we've come through, we're still holding on to the things that people said yesterday. We're still holding on to the pain of yesterday, not knowing that God has brought us through today. Like, unforgiveness is a cancer in the body.
Yes.
In fact, we know this, even people which tend not to forgive more times and often, I can't remember the specific study, please go back, fact check me, right? Tend to fall into sickness and depression more often than others. We see this correlation with unforgiveness, right? And this detachment to not move forward. Unforgiveness becomes a chain. I believe in Scripture, as Joseph saw them, as he worked through his process, he realized that the God that he served had brought him out, and for him to be unforgiven would be to sit there and say, God, even though you brought myself out, I'm going to put myself back into this pit. 17 years, Joseph has to sit there face to face and forgive.
Yes.
How many times in our own lives do we have people which have hurt us that we haven't forgiven? Pastor once said that when we some of us have not forgiven, and some of the people that we haven't forgiven have died and gone on, and all we're doing is carrying their graves on our back every day. Unforgiveness is a burden. I have decided in my life that I will never, right, remain in unforgiveness. Because, quite frankly, I honestly don't see, right, the logic in me losing sleep all night over someone while someone is snoring, right, and drooling and just like not even thinking about it.
Yeah.
But a lot of times, as believers, right, we sit there and we harbor this unforgiveness while the person has moved on with their life.
Yeah.
So the fact is, who is it really hurting? We see here in Joseph's life, I believe that I can infer on the text, not impose on the text, but I believe looking at the text, we can see quite clearly that Joseph realizes that remaining in unforgiveness means remaining in a pit. How many know God wants to remove us? How many know God wants to take us to another level? How many know God wants us to continue to moving forward? When we sit there with unforgiveness in our hearts, it doesn't matter how far we've gotten, we're still back there. Because we're holding on to the things of the past. And we can never enjoy the things of the present and what God wants to do tomorrow. We see this in the text. I believe that Joseph also realized that God had put him in that situation. Like we see in verse 8 right here. He said, so no, it was not you that sent me. A lot of times we go through these situations where people hurt us, right? Where people do damage, when they speak evil to our lives, right? They want to tear you down, they want to bring you down. And not knowing that God is bringing us through that situation. That God is bringing us through that situation purposefully. Joseph says that, listen, it was not you that put me here. God put me here.
Yes.
And when you go through these situations, that God is using that situation so that he can help someone else. A lot of times, God has put us in the pit. So we can also get down in the pit with some of those other people which are down there and help pull them back up. I had the opportunity football team where Elijah's on. And the other day there was an altercation. Me and one of the players, you know, he didn't like being coached, so you know, he just went out. And I went off on him too. I was like, you know, I was telling that Elijah in the cars we were coming back. I said, man, I haven't been that upset in a long time. But once I snapped out of it, I said, no, I gotta go to him. I have to talk to him, right? And I went to talk to him and I apologized. Even if I wasn't wrong, I apologized to him. And I was telling the story to Micah, and Micah said something really interesting to me. He said, man, you know what? Even though that was a bad situation, for the first time, he got to see how a man takes responsibility for his actions. That's what he said, right? He said he got to see how a man, and I started thinking about it as I was going through the study, and I started seeing that sometimes when God puts us in that situation, it's not even just for us. It's for the people that are going through around us. We see that God puts Joseph in this situation where the brothers thought they put him in this situation to deliver Israel, right, from this famine which had come upon them. So this is what happens when we have unforgiveness, when we don't see clearly and we make it about ourselves. We don't even look at the lesson that God is trying to teach us through the process of going into the pit. That's the reason when we get to the pinnacle, we can't even enjoy it. And we don't see that through the trial of going to the pit, back up to the pinnacle, that God, while he was moving us, a lot of times we're like, thank God, God brought me out. Hey, while he was bringing you out, there were people hanging on to you that God was using you to bring them out as well.
Yeah.
But when we make it about us and not what the glory of God is about, right? And I love the Latin phrase, and forgive me all those who know Latin, but I think it's sola Dei Gloria, right? To the glory of God alone. And we see this in Romans 11, right? This capsulation of what's happening in the book of Romans, and basically Paul says everything to the glory of God.
Amen.
And a lot of times, right, we go through situations and we harbor these things and we say, why am I going through? And we don't understand that the reason that God wants to bring us through is for his glory. And his glory is that not only you come out the pit, that everyone around you gets out the pit.
Mm-hmm.
Unforgiveness keeps us in darkness. Unforgiveness keeps us in the pit. And when we're in that stage of unforgiveness, then God's glory, it doesn't become about God's glory. It becomes about you. How long will we sit there? How long will we stay in that place? Even as I was going through some study, I remember just going on my ears and said, Lord, if there's anyone in my heart that I've held unforgiveness, Lord, forgive me. Jesus said it quite simply like this, right? How can you say that you love God, but you don't even love your neighbor?
Yes, that's true.
How can you say you love God, but you don't even love your neighbor? That's devastating, isn't it? It's a devastating statement, right? Because a lot of times it's our neighbors, and in the context, those which we fellowship, right? Those are around, not just maybe those which are right next door to us, but those which are around, those which we fellowship with, all that encompassing, right? Like in the context there, we have people who do some really foul things, which do some really hurtful things. And Jesus says, I don't care if you see me, you love me, you don't even, and you can't see me, but you can't even love the one next to you, the one that you do life with. How can you say that? What a daunting statement that Jesus puts in front of us, right? What a big platform that Jesus puts in front of us. Like Jesus is saying, to love me means to forgive. To love me means to love others. I think one of the hardest things to do, is to forgive those which are in our immediate circle. And I've said this a lot of times, and I repent here on the pulpit, that I don't care what other people around me do, but if someone close to me hurts me, I don't know how to manage it. And Jesus says, even to him, even to her, forgive. To love. Here's the honest against you, then I'm going to be really honest right here. And we're going to, using the scripture, right, as our guide, sola scriptura, scripture alone, right? Then I'm going to have to sit there and say, you're going to have to see, look yourself in the mirror and say, am I really saved?
Yeah.
Do I really follow this Jesus? And that's a very hard thing to say, but it's very true. Am I really saved? If I cannot let go for the sake of the cross, if I can hold on to the burden of yesterday to the point that it affects me, have I really given my heart over to Jesus?
Yeah,
very true. It's very simple. It's very simple. Have I really given my heart over to Jesus? This is the task that we see Joseph going through right here in the text. Are you guys following me? And Joseph says, no, brothers, I forgive you. I'm going to jump ahead real quick. We're going to go to chapter 50. And you see here in the text, in verses 50, he says, and when Joseph's brethren saw that their fathers were dead, they said, Joseph will hate us. They didn't believe that Joseph had forgiven them. They didn't believe that Joseph had forgiven them. I love what scripture says right here. In verses 20 through 21, Joseph looks at them and he weeps. As they're sitting there, right, and they throw themselves before Joseph and say, forgive us. In that moment, how many of us would have been like, I told you, you were going to lie.
Yeah.
You remember those flags and everything that you were making fun of me?
Yeah.
Well, who's the dummy now? He could have easily said that, right? But look what he says. In verse 20, he says, but as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring to pass at this day to save much people. And verse 21, a lot of times we stop right there, but I love what it says in verse 21. It says, now therefore, fear not. I will nourish you and your little ones.
Come on.
Now fear not. I will take care of you and your children.
Yeah.
Joseph forgives. He left that pit a long time ago. He says, I'm not going to be dragged down by this. Because what was meant for evil, right? What was meant for evil? A lot of times we superimpose in the scripture here what the devil meant for evil. That's not what the text says. It says, what was meant for evil? Meaning that sometimes the people around you can even do evil.
Right.
What was meant for evil, God meant for good. When I look at this scripture, this story of Joseph, I see the gospel, quite frankly. I see Joseph being a type of Christ. I see Joseph's brothers being us. Us who are not worthy of forgiveness. Us who had turned our back on Jesus. Us who had walked away. Us who had said, God, I don't want you anymore. And God says, what you had meant for evil, I'm going to make it good. And he sent his son. Romans chapter 5 verses 8 says it like this. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Yeah.
That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Pastor said it this week, we see Christ in every book of the Bible. And I believe so in this book right here, as we look at the story of Joseph. We see Joseph being represented by Jesus. We see his brothers being represented by us. And Jesus saying that I will nourish you. That I will nourish you. That while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.